This conference will now be recorded.
Hello everyone, this is Ram. So let us wait for a couple of minutes to join others. So we can wait for 2 minutes.
Hi Ram, good morning.
Others are joining, just wait for 2 minutes. So fine, we can start the session. So I'm sharing my screen. So can you see my screen? Can you confirm?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So welcome to the session of DevOps. Okay, my name is Ramarao. I'm having 4 years of experience in IT. Last 6 years, I'm working on DevOps practices, and I'm working on multiple projects governed by the DevOps technologies. Okay, fine. So let us start. So basically, what is DevOps? Why we need DevOps? What are the different things we can achieve in the DevOps? And what is the role and responsibilities of DevOps here in real time? So basically, what is DevOps? So DevOps is a process, okay? So it's not a tool, it is a process where the multiple tools are connected to each other to perform the automation of all the activities. Okay, so what is automation? So basically, whatever we are performing the activities in real time, day-to-day activities, okay, like different activities. So those activities we can do in automated way. Okay, so not manually perform, so we can perform in automated way. Okay, using automation tools, we can do automated way. So fine, it's continuous deployments, continuous integration, continuous testing, and continuous monitoring. So what is testing, what is deployments, what is integration, and what is monitoring, we will see in further slides. Okay, fine. So let us go with a little bit history of DevOps. So DevOps arena started nearly in 2008. At that point of time, we are trying to do the automation with different tools, which are old tools. Okay, so Puppet was the tool which was introduced nearly in 2005. At that point of time, we are trying to do the automation with Puppet. So Puppet is a Microsoft tool. Fine. Now, so here we have two sections. So one is developer's point of view and other one is operations. So what is developers? The person who is writing the code and building applications, okay? So developing source code is nothing but developers. And operations, the person who is maintaining the servers, okay, all the servers which are hosted in data centers is nothing but operations. So like operations are nothing but it's a collection of all the servers which are maintained by admins. Okay, fine. And let us take small example here. Let us take small Java project. So for example, if you want to start any startup company or if you want to start any project, so what is required here? The first thing we require, server setup, right? So we need servers. So we will who will set up the servers? Admins will set up the servers. Okay, once admins set up the servers, once install the softwares, whatever the software is required, like Git, Maven, Jenkins, Ansible, whatever the software is required, once we install and once admins install and configure, then the servers will be handover to developers. Developers start their development here. Okay, we are talking about servers, right? So in servers we have so many server groups. Okay, development environment and UAT environment and pre-prod environment and production environment. Okay, so because why we need this many environments? So for example, if you want to deploy any code into production, so before deploying into production, so it should be tested, right? The code should be tested, so it should move through some stages. Okay, first it will move to development servers. Their developers will check the code, then it will move to UAT environment. In UAT environment, testers will test the code, and next it will move to pre-prod. Finally, it will move to production servers. Their deployments will be happen. Okay, so these are the environments, different environments. Fine. Next. So here, These are the servers. These are the three developers. Three developers are working on the same requirement. Okay, so developer one develop the code, and developer two also develop the code, and developer three also done the development. Once that done this development, they will push the code to integrated servers. Okay, so basically in local, they develop their code in their local. Okay, so in local, we don't find any issues. For example, in our local desktop, so if you create any folder, if you delete any folder, if you add any files into that folder, you will not face any issues. Okay, so whenever you push that code to integrated servers, means development servers, UAT servers, and production servers, pre-prod servers, so when you move this code to integrated servers, there we will find the actual issues. So for example, Developer one wrote the code like x equal to 5. Developer two wrote the code is like x equal to 10. And developer three wrote the code x equal to 15. So the three developers are working on the same requirement. Once develop the code, they will push the code to integrated servers. There we will find the issues. So in DevOps also, as a DevOps engineer, so in real time, so this type of issues we'll face, okay? So how to fix that issues and all, we'll discuss later, okay? So fine. So in local, we don't find any issues. When we move to integrated servers, there we'll find the issues, fine? So using DevOps tools, before that, fine. So here, servers are set up by admins, right? And developers are developing the code, testers are testing the code, okay? So who is moving the code from one environment to other environment, okay? So here, DevOps engineer will be moved the code to code from one environment to other environment. So here, DevOps engineers came into the picture, okay? Fine. Next, using DevOps tools, how to deploy the code? We'll try to understand. So these are the DevOps tools. So basically, this is local Git, okay? In local Git, three users are working, okay? So Git local. So they are working on local. Once complete the development in local, they will push the code to GitHub. GitHub means this is remote repository, okay? So basically, what is Git? Git is a repository tool or version control tool. What is repository? So where we save our data is nothing but repository. Where we save our source code is nothing but repository. So it can be any data. It can be binary files, image files, or video files. So any data, where we save our data is nothing but repository. And version control, what is version control? So here we have some parameters. So what are those parameters? So what is version control? So who did changes? And when did changes? And what purpose they did changes? Okay, so Git will allow these comments. Okay, based on these comments, Git will track the versioning. Who did changes? Okay, so Rama did changes. And when did changes? So at 8 a.m. did some changes, and what purpose did changes? Due to some production issue, it did some changes. Based on these comments, Git will track the versioning. Okay, so basically in Java we'll have 100 200 lines code, right? So in Java, for example, one developer develop the code in Java. So after 2 months, if he come back and check the code, he may not understand who developed this code. Okay, but to track that development, so we use version control here. Git will have version control system here. Okay, using Git will track the versioning. Who did changes, when did changes, and what purpose they did changes. Okay. Fine. Next, so Git and GitHub, there is no difference. Git is, this is local Git, this is remote repository. Okay, there is no difference between Git and GitHub. Okay, fine. Next, Jenkins. So what is Jenkins? What Jenkins will do? Jenkins is a CI/CD tool. So continuous integration and continuous delivery. Okay, so it will, it is act as a mediator tool. So in DevOps, we have so many tools, right? So all are individual tools. One tool cannot communicate other tools, other tool, right? By using Jenkins, we'll communicate all the tools. We integrate all the tools, okay? By installing plugins. So for example, if I want to communicate GitHub, okay? I install GitHub plugin in Jenkins. Then I'll be able to communicate GitHub. For example, if I want to pull the code from GitHub to Jenkins, so I need to install GitHub plugin in Jenkins. Then only I will be able to communicate GitHub. Right? Fine. So yeah, here in Jenkins, we'll create some jobs. Okay. If you want to pull the code from GitHub to Jenkins, we'll write some job here. Okay. Pull code from GitHub. Okay, we'll pull the code from GitHub to Jenkins. Fine. Next, Maven. So Maven is a build tool. It will generate artifacts. Okay. So what is artifact? Artifact is nothing but archive file. Okay. So based on the application, it will generate archive file. Okay. So if the application is Java application, it will generate jar file, Java archive file. If the application is web application, it will generate WAR file, web archive file. If the application is enterprise application, it will generate EAR file, enterprise archive file. Based on the application, it will generate the archive file. Okay. So why we need Maven here? So basically, so our code is in GitHub. Jenkins will pull the code from GitHub to Jenkins, okay? And it will push the code to Maven to generate artifacts. And again, it will give back to, Maven will give back to Jenkins. Then Jenkins will push the code to application server. Here deployments will be happen. Okay, so here question. So Maven, normally, so if you want to deploy any code from GitHub to application server, so why we require Maven? Directly we can pull, we can push to application server, right? So why we need Maven here? So because, so in GitHub we'll have raw code, okay? Raw code will not understand by application server, okay? Only binary file formats will be allowed. Okay, it will understand, application server will understand only binary formats. Okay, so that is why we are using Maven here. So Maven will generate archive file, is a binary file, and it will give back to Jenkins. Jenkins will push the code to application server. Here deployments will be happen. Okay, any doubts, any questions here?
This Maven will get the information from Jenkins itself. It is not taking anything from the GitHub or Git, or will it take?
Yeah, it will not directly take from GitHub. Okay, so Jenkins will provide the data to Maven.
Okay, basically Jenkins will interact with all other tools, whatever the required for the development, and it will interact with the Maven. Maven will just do the conversion of understandable format to the development environment.
Exactly.
And it will push. Okay.
Exactly. Okay. Thank you. So because raw code, we cannot push directly to application server. Okay. So for example, if you have 100 documents in your system, okay, so I ask you to send those documents to me. So what is the simplest way to send those documents to me? For example, you have Word documents.
Email or format, file format, FTP, any location.
Yeah. You will zip that 100 files and you will send to me, right?
You can. Yeah, in zip, I can do it and I can send it.
Yes. So the same way, same functionality will work here, okay? So in the GitHub, we'll have raw code. Maven will generate as a binary file, as a single file, and it will give back to Jenkins. Jenkins will push the code to application server. So here deployments will be happened. Right?
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
This is the case. Okay, Jenkins will push the code to Maven. Maven will generate the artifact and it will give back to Jenkins. Then here deployments will be happen. So basically this is build and release process. So normal build and release process. Okay, so normally we don't do deployment like this. Okay, so earlier we used to use like this. In my career beginning, we used to use like this. Now we have automation tools. Okay, so what are those tools? So these are the automation tools. So Ansible, Chef, and Puppet. Okay, Ansible is, so it is widely using. So most of the projects, they are using Ansible. It is very high secure and very advanced tool. Okay, Chef also using some projects. Okay, so Puppet is very less projects. Okay, so Puppet is a very old tool. So very less projects are using. Fine. So yeah, in our classes we work on Ansible and Chef. Okay, we don't have Puppet in our content. Fine. So before discussing about Ansible, I'll give you one requirement. Okay. So here I have 300 servers. So I want to install Java on 300 servers. Okay. These servers are not in automation. These are bare servers. We need to install Java on 300 servers. What is the process?
We have to reach the server each and individual, and we have to, if they are not in a shared thing, we have to deploy separately, individually,
right?
To that it's required all dependency file support. Before it required some prerequisites, the and all should be installed, and we have to do.
So basically we have 300 servers. So let us take one step by step. Okay, so I want to install Java on single server. What are the steps? First, what we need to do? First, we'll take RDP, right? Remote desktop. Fine. So go to run MSDSC. So if it is Windows servers, we'll take RDP. So here we'll give IP address or server name and connect. So it will ask you username and password. So basically I haven't connected VPN, that is why it is giving some error. Fine. So what will happen here? Once we connect here, it will ask you username and password. Okay, so we need to supply the username and password. So username and password. So once we connect the server, then we need Java software, right? So in real time, we don't use any CDs. Okay, we don't connect any pen drives. So basically in central repositories, we will have all the softwares. Like central repository means share folders. Share folders are share paths. Okay, central repositories. We have all the softwares. From there, we need to copy Java software into your server. Okay, fine. So once we copy the software, then we need to install that. First, we need to check whether installed or not. Okay, if it is not installed, we need to install the Java software. Okay, once we install this Java software, so if the server is Windows server, so we need to set the environment variables. Okay, environment variables we need to set. Okay, once we set the environment variables, we need to reboot the server. So without reboot, the changes will not be affected. So we need to reboot the server. right? So once we reboot the server, it is successfully completed. So for example, if the person is 2 to 3 years experienced person, how much time it will take to install this Java? How many minutes it will take? How much time it will take minimum? So it will take 20 minutes minimum, right? If the person is 2 to 3 years experienced person. Okay, if the person is an expert or experienced person, he may take 15 minutes, right? So let us assume 10 minutes. Okay, so 10 into 300 servers. So for installing Java, so it will take 3000 minutes. Okay, for installing Java, it is taking 3000 minutes. So this kind of request every day will get so many requests in our project. Okay, so if you want to, like, if you take this way, so manual way, it takes hours, days, weeks. Okay, so one person will come and ask you, I want only Java 1.7, I don't want 1.8. okay, I don't want Java, so it should be uninstalled. Okay, one person will come and ask you, so I want this plugin. Okay, so like that, so many requests will come every day. Okay, if you do manual way, so it will take a lot of time, right? So this time consumption, like this manual efforts, to avoid this manual efforts, we have automation tools. So which are Ansible, Puppet, and Chef, right? So the same requirement, so Java instruction 300 servers, how to deploy using Ansible on 300 servers, we'll try to understand. Okay. So this is Ansible. So let us take one more. Yeah. So this is my Ansible server. Okay, so we want to install, we need to install Java on 300 servers. Okay, so here I have 100 development servers and 100 UAT servers, 100 production servers. Okay, so on 300 servers we need to install Java. Okay, so first we need to configure Ansible server here. Okay, we'll take one EC2 instance, and on that we need to install, configure Ansible server. Okay, so these are our project servers. Okay, so on these servers we need to install Java. So first, what we need to do, first we need to establish the authentication between this Ansible server to development servers. Okay, so for which we use here SSH authentication. SSH authentication. So here we have two types of authentications. Okay, so one is key-based authentication, and the second one is user-based authentication. Okay, so we use authentication. Okay, we establish the connection between Ansible and Ansible server and development servers. Okay, next, what we need to do, we need to prepare the inventory groups. Okay, so what is inventory? So inventory is nothing but server information. Okay, so basically, so for example, I'll show you some inventory here. So in our, we are maintaining some inventory here. Yeah, this is our inventory. Inventory is nothing but it is server information. Yeah. So if you observe here, So host name, CA description, region, subregion, country, city, okay, DC location, DC name, so IP address of the server, okay, what is voice and domain name. Okay, all the information is available here. Okay, this is sample inventory. Fine. So like that, we need to prepare some inventory here. So here inventory means we don't need to give all the information. We just give IP address. That's it. For example, dev environment. So we have dev environment. So development servers IP addresses we need to give here. So for example, 10.109.32.10, something like, okay. So development servers, 100 servers, 100 IPs we need to give manually. This is first time activity, one time activity. So first time we need to give all the IP addresses. Whatever IPs we have in development environment, we need to copy IP addresses here, okay. And same way, UAT also, we need to give all the IPs, okay. So same way, production also, we need to give all the IPs. Okay, so once we prepare the inventory, next we need to dot YML script we need to prepare. Okay, dot YML script. So script is nothing but it is a playbook. We can call it as a playbook. Okay, so for example, if you want to install Java on 300 servers, you need to prepare some YAML file, YAML script, okay, which is, you can call it as playbook, okay. So playbook, I'll show you some sample playbook here, okay. So it's very simple, very small script, okay. Simple playbook to install Tomcat. Yeah, so if you want to install Java, this is only the playbook. Okay, so fine. So one second. Yeah, so this is the playbook. If you want to install Java, this is the playbook. So this is for our understanding. Okay, install Java 1.7. So we don't require this. So this is enough. Okay, this is only the playbook. M colon name equal to java-1.7.0-openjdk, state equal to present. Okay, so we prepare YAML script here. This is the script, YAML script. So to install Java. So if you want to uninstall Java, so in place of present, we put absent. Okay, if you want to uninstall the Java from all the servers, okay. Fine. So once we prepare the script, okay, so here host file is there, host file. So host file, we need to connect, okay. So if you want to install on development servers, so host file, so we need to give dev only, okay. So once we give dev and you run the script, next connect. Connect. Okay, once we give dev and connect the development servers, so it will automatically install Java and development servers. So if you want to install development and UAT servers, you can give like this. Okay, so and connect the environments. Once you connect that, it will install Java and development servers and UAT servers within 5 minutes. So if you give all here, all, so it will install Java on all the servers within 5 minutes. Okay, so we prepare script here and we connect all, so host file all, and connect the servers. Connect means run the playbook. Okay, so it will install parallelly. So within 5 minutes, it will install Java on all the servers, not only 300 servers. If you have 2000 servers, 3000 servers, you can spin up within 5 minutes. You can install Java on all the servers within 5 minutes using Ansible. So once the installation is completed, so it will provide you one report. How many servers are deployed? How many servers are pending? How many servers are failed? How many servers are unreachable? That report will be provided by Ansible. So based on that, if any servers are unreachable or failed, you need to identify and you need to run it again. Okay, any doubts in this slide? Yeah, this is Ansible server. Any questions, any doubts in this?
No, Ram, so far.
Yeah. Fine. So we integrate Ansible server here. Okay. Normally in build and release process, we don't do manually. So we integrate Ansible server here in between application server and Jenkins server. So from Jenkins, we'll trigger the job. Ansible will perform automatically deployments. Okay. Fine. So in our course, these are the tools we are going to discuss. Okay. First, we'll start with AWS. So AWS, in AWS, we work on infrastructure services. Okay. So I'll show you content also. Once completed the AWS, we'll work on Linux basics. So Linux basics will be taken like 3 to 4 sessions. Okay. What is Linux architecture? What is the folder structure? What are the commands we are going to use? And what are the features of Linux? Okay. History of Linux. So many things we'll discuss. Once completed the Linux, we'll start with Git. Git, GitHub, Jenkins, Maven, Ansible, Chef, Docker. So after that, Kubernetes, Terraform. So Docker, Kubernetes, Terraform, these are very, very advanced tools. Okay. So also we have Nexus Artifactory tool and Sonar Code Review tool. So Nexus Artifactory means, so it is, it will save our artifacts. Okay. Sonar Code Review means, so every project team will maintain some standards, code standards. Okay. For which we use Sonar Code Review tool. So we have so many tools in market, but this is very, very famous tool. So most of the projects, 70% of the projects, using Sonar Code Review tool. Okay, these are the tools we are going to discuss. And one more thing, so here we discussed about servers, right? On-premises servers, on-premises setup we discussed, like, so these are the on-premises servers. On the servers we have we discussed about some Java installation, right? So here, once the servers are moved from on-premises to cloud, on-premises means our local data center, local servers. Once the servers are moved from on-premises to cloud, so there is no admin role under the incoming. We'll not have any admin role. We don't require any admin role, because in cloud, 80% of the work will be taken care by, 80% of the activities will be taken care by cloud vendor. Other 20% we need to take care. We need to create infrastructure, means servers, and we need to maintain. As a DevOps engineer, we need to create servers, in cloud, and we need to maintain the servers. Fine. Yeah, and one more thing. So this is the 2019 representation. So DevOps growth. So in 2020, okay. So according to collective study, the DevOps market generated 2.9 billion in 2017, and the market is expected to reach 6.6 billion by 2022. Okay, and DevOps is going to be the mainstream and going to reach its peak in 2020. Okay, so this is the representation given by one of the job portal. So now the DevOps market is very good. Okay, so many opportunities. So in our project also, we are getting so many mails every day. So we'll take some session, some weekend, alternate weekend interviews. Okay, we are also getting so many emails. So even last week also we got some emails. Fine. So and I'll show you some. Hope you receive the content. So I'll show you that. This is the content. So basically, so everyone having some questions here. So as a DevOps engineers, if you want to learn DevOps, so you don't require any development knowledge and testing knowledge and QA knowledge. Okay, so anyway, every demo people used to ask, so do I need to have development knowledge to learn DevOps? So we don't require any development knowledge, we don't require any testing knowledge. So DevOps in your role is different role. So here we deploy the code and we automate the activities, okay, automation activities, and we will run the jobs. Okay, this is different role. Okay, this is the content. So we'll start with AWS first. So these are the AWS services we are going to discuss. Okay, so EC2, S3, EBS, IAM, AMI. So these are the services we are going to discuss. Okay, it will take 10 to 12 days to complete AWS. After that, we'll work on Linux basics. Then we'll start the Git. Every tool will go deeper. Okay, so every tool, for example, Git is there. Yeah, Git, Washlet Control System. We'll go deeper. Okay, Git will take 1 week. Okay, so next we'll start Jenkins. So Jenkins will go deeper. So not installation configuration, not like that. Every tool will go deeper. Okay, so any questions in this, any doubts up to here?
Ram, this is you are saying this is in configuration side you are working, or because I'm working in testing side, so Python mm-hmm. and all it is required, right, for this roles and all?
No, not required. So in our project we are 25 people. Okay, no one has scripting knowledge, so we don't require. It is not mandatory. So if you have scripting knowledge, it would be added advantage. So normally we don't require any scripting knowledge. So if you know basics like bash scripting or Python scripting, it would be added advantage.
Okay, for the configuration role, whatever you are explaining, right? DevOps configuration role.
Correct. So okay. Basically for writing playbooks, right? Scripts, right?
So, yeah.
No, don't require any configuration role. So this is YAML file. Basically, this is YML file. So yeah. We have some Ansible will provide some Galaxy. Okay, so okay. I'll show you that.
So because I'm also working in same server side, but like the same thing, I am looking forward to everything they are moving to this side, like a DevOps side, mostly Kubernetes and Jenkins. So Python and robotic framework we are using. So I am thinking simultaneously along with this Python I want to learn. So that's just I want to know whether Python is required for this.
Python is basically not required. This is YAML script. Basically here, Ansible will provide some Ansible Galaxy.
Okay.
Ansible Galaxy. So here you will get all the scripts. Okay. So just if you go here, so you will get all the scripts, sample scripts from here. For example, if you want to have database related scripts or packaging scripts, click on this. Okay, so like here you can search anything Java. So if you click on this JavaScript something Java scripts, so it will redirect to GitHub. Click on GitHub repo. So here the sample code will be, sample scripts will be available. So tasks, click on tasks. Main YAML file.
It's public repo, right? This is
public repo, correct. So here you will have all the scripts from here. You can copy and paste. You can customize a few things, like you can use. Also, we have Ansible roles also there. Ansible will provide all the galaxies. Okay, from you can pick the scripts and you can use the scripts. No need to worry about I need to prepare my own. Not like that. So we are also using this same Ansible Galaxy in our project.
Okay.
Right. Any more questions? Any more doubts? Fine. So from tomorrow we'll start the regular sessions. Okay. Tomorrow. And day after tomorrow also we have some introductions like AWS and some introductions we have. So we from tomorrow we'll have regular sessions. So can you ping your email ID and phone number here in the chat so that our backend people will take that and they will communicate you. So here I'm pinging. So in that chat, can you ping your phone number and email ID? Yeah, I got from Pradeep. So Harika Garu and
how to do this, sir?
Sorry?
Where should I hello?
Yeah, here we have chat right in the meeting. Go to meeting, we have chat icon. So okay. Just click. Yeah. So from tomorrow, the same timing, 8 to 9. So
Ram, ఏదన చేంజ్ అయ్యేది ఉందా టైమింగ్ మీది ఫిక్స్ అయ్యేది 8 to 9
ఈ టైమింగ్ మీకు ప్రాబ్లం ఉందా అంటే మీకు ఏమైనా మీటింగ్స్ లో ఉంటే
అంటే ఇప్పుడంతా వర్క్ ఫ్రమ్ హోమ్ సో నేను బెంగళూరు లో అన్నమాట అదే నేనంతా ఇప్పుడు వర్క్ ఫ్రమ్ హోమ్ కానీ తెలియదు మనకి ఒక 1 మంత్ అలా తర్వాత లేకపోతే నెక్స్ట్ 2 వీక్స్ లో వాళ్ళు ఎక్స్ప్లెయిన్ ఏంటో తెలియదు. సో ఇఫ్ ఎనీ చేంజెస్ అండ్ ఆల్ లెట్ మీ నో, ఆర్ ఎల్స్ ఐ విల్ పింగ్ యూ హియర్ ఓన్లీ ఆర్ యువర్ ఈమెయిల్ ఐడి ఐ కెన్ హ్యావ్ ఆర్ ఫోన్ నంబర్ ఆర్ సంథింగ్.
Yeah, so Arsha email ID is there, right? You got some invite, right? For that,
yeah, training. Okay,
correct. Yeah,
so you want me to check with her? Okay, yeah, I'll check with her.
Fine, meeku inka raledandi meedi Harika garu.
I'm doing so.
మీది అంటే చార్ట్ మీరు ఐకాన్ ఉంటుంది చూడండి, వైట్ కలర్ ఐకాన్ ఉంటుంది. వి కెన్ స్టాప్ హియర్ ఫర్ టుడే. సో టుమారో విల్ వర్క్ ఆన్ విల్ డిస్కస్ AWS సెషన్. ఓకే, AWS ఇంట్రొడక్షన్. సో వాట్ ఆర్ ద థింగ్స్ వి హావ్, వాట్ ఈస్ క్లౌడ్ and what are the things we have in AWS. So we'll try to understand tomorrow. So if you don't have any questions here, we can conclude the session. Yeah, thank you all. Thank you.